Hello, this is Lazarus at telecomTech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining how to configure OSPF network types. Let me remind you very quickly, I have a 27-page networking professionals career roadmap. You can find it free at the link below. You can also check out my website for more goodies and in-depth courses. And if you like this video and this series of videos, you can subscribe, like, and hit the bell icon. In the previous video, we went over the five different OSPF network types. We explained in detail how each one operates based on the capabilities and the topological arrangement of the underlying transport technology. Now, the transport technology can include things like MPLS, SD-WAN, VPNs, frame relay, and others. Different topologies and different technologies need different OSPF network type configurations to make them work. Here is a table that summarizes how OSPF behaves for each network type. It also tells us what additional configurations may be necessary for each one to work correctly. Now let's take a closer look at each one of these from a configuration standpoint. We'll be using this topology here. We will only be dealing with OSPF mechanisms such as neighbor adjacencies and DRBDR elections. We won't be configuring any exchange of actual routing information. The purpose is to see how these network types make the interaction between OSPF routers behave differently. Now, the interfaces of the devices we'll be using are Ethernet interfaces, but we can configure them with any network type we want and observe the results. For all of the network types we'll be looking at, we can assume that OSPF has already been configured like so. Now, these commands applied to both R1 and R2 will create a successful OSPF adjacency over this link. We haven't configured the OSPF priority or a loopback address, so the router ID adopted by each router should be the highest IP on an active interface. Since we are only configuring one interface, it should be the IP address of the gigabit Ethernet 00 interface of each router. Let's take a look at our first network type, which is broadcast. To get this to work, we don't actually have to do anything. Since we are using Ethernet interfaces, broadcast is the default. The result is that these devices become OSPF neighbors and they take part in an automatic DRBDR election. We can see the results of all of this by looking at the output of this command. We can see neighbor adjacencies, and we can see the DR and BDR that have been chosen. That's broadcast. Adjacencies are created automatically, and a DRBDR election takes place automatically. Next, we have the non-broadcast multiple access network type, or NBMA. This is how we configure it on each router. It's a simple interface command on both ends. Let's see how this affects the OSPF adjacency. There's actually no adjacency. Why? Because an NBMA network doesn't support multicast. That's what the non-broadcast indicates. This network type requires that we manually configure the neighbor adjacencies. Otherwise, adjacencies won't come up. So to do this, we issue the following commands. We simply use the neighbor command on the OSPF configuration of both R1 and R2 and indicate that we want to manually create a neighbor with the IP address of the other router. Once that's done, the routers begin exchanging hellos using unicast addresses, those of the configured neighbor commands. The result is a neighbor adjacency, as you can see here, as well as a successful DR-BDR election. So if we had, say, a DMVPN topology or an implementation of MPLS layer 2 VPNs where multicast isn't available, by default, OSPF wouldn't work. But we could configure the interfaces using these commands and routers would successfully operate OSPF between them. So that's non-broadcast multiple access, manual configuration of neighbors, but the rest OSPF does on its own. Now we go on to our point-to-point network type. At this point, we've removed our static configuration of the neighbor. We can now configure our interfaces for the point-to-point network type using this command here. Now, I would like to note that each interface can only be configured with one OSPF network type. This means that every time we issue the command, it overwrites the previous network type that we may have assigned. Let's see what the results here are. In a point-to-point network, multicast will work, so the neighbors are established automatically. However, with such a network type, the OSPF routers are instructed not to take part in DRBDR elections. As you can see here, where we would expect to see DR, BDR, or DR other, we see just a hyphen. You can also see that the priority of both routers is set to zero. This is done automatically with a point-to-point network type and is the reason for which there is no election. So this would be employed if you have a point-to-point VPN or a serial link, for example. That's the point-to-point network type. We have automatic neighbor discovery, but no DRBDR elections take place because they're not needed. Let's go on to the point-to-multipoint network. Now, I've modified our topology here just a bit so we can get a better feeling about what we're doing here. We have three routers now in a hub and spoke topology. R1 is our hub and R2 and R3 are spokes. I put a cloud here representing the network because this can be anything that supports point-to-multipoint topologies. Practically speaking, in our case, it's a switch, but we want to simulate an actual point-to-multipoint scenario. So in this case, we apply this configuration to the interfaces. I'm just showing what we would do on R2. R3 would have the same configuration as R2. What results would we see? Well, remember that point-to-multipoint network types simply act as a collection of point-to-point network type links, resulting in a hub and spoke topology. One of those routers will play the role of the hub based on the underlying topology. In our case, R1 is the hub. We can see that R1 has automatically created adjacencies with R2 and R3 because the point-to-multipoint network type supports multicast. We also see that we have no DRBDR elections. If you look at R2, you will see that it has become a neighbor only with R1, which is the hub, which is also expected, since that acts as a point-to-point link type. If we look at R3, we'll see something similar. So this would be employed if you have a point-to-multipoint VPN topology or a DMVPN topology. So that's point-to-multipoint network type. We have automatic neighbor discovery between the hub and each spoke, as if each one is a point-to-point network type. And we have no DRBDR elections because they're not needed on individual point-to-point links. Finally, we come to our point-to-multipoint non-broadcast network type. This is used for topologies that are a collection of point-to-point links with a hub, but that don't support multicast. So let's take a look at the resulting neighbor relationships for OSPF. As expected, we don't see any adjacencies. The non-broadcast nature of this network type means multicast is not supported, so no automatic neighbors are formed. We have to manually configure our neighbors. Now, the behavior here is the same as the point-to-multipoint network type, except that we manually configure our neighbors because there is no support for multicast. The result is, once again, that R1 has two neighbors and all router priorities are set to zero, so there is no DRBDR election. You can see the single neighbor adjacency that can be found in R2. The same would be seen if we looked at R3 as well. Now, just some things to remember about OSPF network types. The network type configuration should match on both ends of the link. You will find that OSPF may still work if you have a different network type on each end. If you experiment with it, you'll find out which ones actually work together. But it's always best practice to keep the configuration consistent and configure the same network type on both ends. The same goes for manual OSPF neighbor configurations. You will find that an OSPF neighbor may actually come up if you configure it manually only on one end, but you should apply it on both OSPF routers for consistency. Also, the choice of network type must match the requirements of your underlying transport technology. You may find that for a particular technology, several network types will work with differing configurations on your static neighbors and DRBDR priorities. Make sure you apply the most appropriate parameters for your situation. Now remember, network types have been tried and tested on many topologies and on many technologies, so you don't have to reinvent the wheel when choosing the network type. Check out white papers and published best practices. Well, I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. Please check out my website and register for my newsletter. You'll find the links in the description below. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.